This episode of the Grand Rising Show was brought to you by Autochthonous Assembly, where the real work gets done. Autochthonous Assembly is a gathering of the minds that do the work. Now, for many of our first-time subscribers and first-time visitors, you may be wondering who Autochthonous Assembly are. You can find this information about our mission statement and our core values on the website at autochthonousassembly.com/about. We are a nonprofit organization dedicated to raising up Indigenous American voices by using genealogy, also known as family history or your family tree, which is the study of families and the tracing of their lineages and history. Genealogists use oral interviews, historical records, genetic analysis, and other records to obtain information about a family and to demonstrate kinship and pedigrees of its members. Our core values are the foundation of our company, which is essential to our success and serve as a lens through which we evaluate every business decision. Those core values are, but are not limited to, integrity, which is knowing and doing what is right, respect, which is treating others the way you want to be treated, responsibility, which is embracing opportunities to contribute, and servant leadership, which is serving the common good. Now, at Autochthonous Assembly, we have a couple of goals here. And our first goal and foremost of the reason why we do everything that we do is to ensure that we help you do your genealogy and connect back to your tribe and find out where you are from. Everything that we do from the standpoint of the Grand Rising Show and all the information that's posted on the website is dedicated to that one specific purpose, helping you find your genealogy, find your relatives, find your family so that you will know exactly who you are. And if you choose to, tie back into your tribe, whether that tribe is a Native American tribe, an American Indian tribe, whether it's allowing you to determine which house in Africa that you belong to, or what clan of Scandinavia or Europe or France that you belong to. Either way, our goal is to do just that, help you find out who you are so you know exactly where to start. We are not here to tell you who you are, and we're not here to tell you who you are not. We're just here to help you discover your beginnings. Another one of our missions is to help you become financially independent so that you can help your generations for the next seven generations and be able to put a stable foundation for you and your relatives. And if you should choose to use this information that we provide free of charge to help not only yourself, but your community and your tribe, then we will do everything in our power to make sure that gets done as well. And remember, our goal here is to make sure that we help you get exposed to this information to put you in the best situation possible. So now what I'm going to do now is return it back over to the panel to see if there was anything I missed. And I will go ahead and get set up so we can get ready and get digging into this information. Panel, take it away.
Warning, warning, warning. Hard hats, pickaxe, shovel, boots required.
Grand Rising, everyone. Greetings, greetings. Hope all is well with everyone. How's the panel this rising?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm feeling great. No complaints. A lot of reading.
Are we live?
We yes. are live.
We're live, right?
We yes. are live.
Okay, we're live. Grand Rising to the chat and to the panel. Grand Rising, everybody.
Scarred for life, huh?
So how was everyone's weekend?
It was pretty good. Pretty good. A lot of reading. Definitely good, though.
Yeah, yeah. I like the one video on the, shout out to No Sellout for that one, on the walking through of a community garden.
Shout out to Double Cousin. Absolutely.
I mean, basically, it's a full walkthrough.
Yeah, that's a positive turnaround.
Mm-hmm. So that was your weekend, No Sellout. I probably had to step away. And other than that, anybody watch the big game?
Not the whole thing. I saw bits and pieces. Watched it from a definitely different perspective. With some new eyes.
Well, I know that feeling.
Man, messing around with a touch and assembly can't look at nothing right no more. Can't even be entertained. Nope.
I just seen a whole lot of funding.
Man, I saw funding. I saw what's it called? Something like presentation, but not presentation, like advertisement. I saw advertisement. I saw promotion. I saw HUD. I saw United States Census. I saw USDA. I just saw a whole lot of stuff. Wait, what? Okay, it's right there.
Mm-hmm.
Attached to music, uniforms. like I said, attached to this assembly, got it to where I can't look at nothing right no more. It ain't the same. It ain't the same. It is not the same. I mean, even down to, I saw census, I saw promotion and everything, you know, promoting different things to the point where I was just like, wow. And it's wrapped up in music. It's wrapped up in dance. It's all wrapped up.
As entertainment.
Yes, it's wrapped up. It was like watching a musical. Like Grease or Cats or something like that. It was just like, wow, really? Everybody just singing along. Hold on. Dude Division says, shout out to Dude Division Grand Rising. He says, I see dead people. David Corey says hidden messages. Yeah, I can't even say they were hidden. It was right there. I'm just looking at it like, what? I'm looking at on the job training.
I'm gonna go ahead and knock these shout outs real quick. Grand Rising to Big Nelsa, Celestial Love, David Corey, Doodoo Vision, Macadon One, Phoenix Rose, Tiny Ofo Ofofo, No Sellout, and that's all I see in the chat at this moment. Let me open up the other one and see if I missed someone.
I think you forgot Michael Harris Brown Cheek.
I'm checking the other one right now.
Okay, my bad. Don't yell at me.
Yep, no, that's everyone.
Oh, you forgot TMH.
Well, I'm only calling the ones I see on the screen. You know, we always let you call.
I'm in the chat. I see it. I'm not crazy. Well, I mean, yeah, but I'm not insane.
Now that makes everybody that's here though.
Okay.
Well, other than that, everybody good? About to get ready to go through this information is rising. Let me pull this back up. Posting this link in the chat real quick. Posted in the chat, and it's rising. We'll be going through community development on what it is, breaking down the different programs, and basically how to access them and how you can use them to better your community. Everyone on the panel got the link?
Yeah, I got the link up.
You can start off reading the first paragraph. I'll catch down. I'll take the second one. If you was able to.
All right. Okay. Community development. What is community development? Community development activities build stronger and more resilient communities through an ongoing process of identifying and addressing needs, assets, and priority investments. Community development activities may support infrastructure, economic development projects, installation of public facilities, community centers, housing rehabilitation, public services, clearance, acquisition, micro enterprise assistance, code enforcement, homeowner assistance, and many other identified needs. Federal support for community development encourages systematic and sustained action by state and local governments. Where can individuals find assistance? Individuals looking for assistance can find rental, home buyer, or homeowner assistance. Find resources for homeless persons, including youth, veterans, and chronically homeless. Find help for victims of foreclosure and Hurricane Sandy and persons living with HIV/AIDS.
So basically more programs. All right. I'll take the next one. It says, what is HUD doing to support community development? The Office of Block Grant Assistance administers funds allocated to the state and local governments to address locally identified community development needs. The first one, it says CDBG Entitlement Program, provides annual grants on a formula based to entitle cities and counties to develop viable urban communities by providing decent housing and a suitable living environment, and by expanding economic opportunities, principally for low and moderate income persons. Next is CDBG State Program. Allows states to award grants to smaller units of general local government that develop and preserve decent affordable housing to provide services to the most vulnerable in our communities and to create and retain jobs. The next one is CDBG HUD Administrated Non-Entitled Counties and Hawaii Program. Provides annual grants on a formula based to Hawaii, Kua and Maui counties to provide decent housing and suitable living environment and expand economic opportunities, principally for low and moderate income persons. CDBG Insular Area Program provides grants to 4 designated insular areas: American Samoa, Guam, Northern Mariana Islands, and the U.S. Virgin Islands to provide decent housing and suitable living environment and expanded economic opportunities, principally for low and moderate income persons. I don't know if y'all noticing this yet, but next, CDBG Program, Colonists Set Aside, requires that border states of Arizona, California, New Mexico, and Texas to set aside a percentage of their annual state CDBG allocations for the use in the colonia to help meet the needs of the colonist residents in relationship to the need for portable water, adequate sewer systems, or decent, safe, and sanitary housing. Next, they have Section 108 Loan Guarantee Program. It's the loan guarantee provision of the CDBG program and provides communities with a source of financing for economic development, housing rehabilitation, public facilities, and a large-scale physical development project.
Hold on.
We're going to break them all back down.
Okay, I just wanted to hear that one more again.
Oh, I read
it like all of us.
We were gonna go back to the top and click on each one. I was just reading through it.
I got you.
Because I clicked and I was like, wait a minute.
Stop clicking.
Wait a minute, that caught my ear.
You can take the first one after I finish reading them all off. Ooh, we'll go back to the top and just click each one and go through each program.
Okay.
All right, next program is CDBG Disaster Recovery Program. Provides flexible grants to help cities, counties, and states recover from presidentially declared disasters, especially in low-income areas, subject to availability on supplemental appropriations. Next, the Neighborhood Stabilization Program provides grants to communities that suffered from foreclosures and abandonment to purchase and redevelop foreclosed and abandoned homes and residential property. Congress authorized NSP grants between 2008 and 2011. No new funds are available. Next, Brownfields Economic Development Initiative provides grants to assist cities with the redevelopment of abandoned, idle, underused industrial and commercial facilities where expansion and redevelopment is burdened by redevelopment is burdened by real or potential environmental contamination. And that's all the ones on the list. We can go back to the first one. It's the CDBG Entitlement Program. Someone was reading off that one.
I'm sorry, say that again, please.
Yeah, I just clicked it. I was trying to get to it. My bad. We leaving HUD exchange. We're leaving HUD. Open a new window. Community Development Block Grant Entitlement Program. Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So the Community Development Block Grant Entitlement Program provides annual grants on a formula basis to entitled cities and counties to develop viable urban communities by providing decent housing and suitable living environment and by expanding economic opportunities, principally for low and moderate income persons. The program is authorized under Title I of the Housing and Community Development Act of 1974, Public Law 93-383, as amended, 42 USC-530.1. Sick. I don't know what that means. This collection of products... No, this is not. Is that right? Yes. Will help grantees create transformative impact in your community, improve the lives of residents, especially those with low and moderate income levels, develop strategies that bring partners and resources together, and implement your program effectively. I'm about to click view and explore. I already did it. Explore CDBG. Anybody? Anyone? Bueller?
Yes, go ahead.
Small link. So Explore CDBG is the link I clicked at the bottom. As a community development professional who works on projects funded through the Community Development Block Grant Program, CDBG, you may have wondered how to use CDBG funds to create transformative impact in your community, improve the lives of all residents, and especially those who with low and income, moderate income levels. Develop strategies that bring partners and resources together, leveraging funds and building community assets, and implement your program effectively, increasing the likelihood of successful projects.
Oh, read that last line. Let's say with the help, please do.
Oh man, I'm gonna read the last. No, implement your program.
No, it said to help answer these.
Oh yeah. To help answer these questions, HUD has created Explore CDBG, a collection of online technical assistance products. Hold up, you ain't flying this by the seat of your pants? You ain't flying blind?
What was that one more time?
To help answer these questions, HUD has created Explore CDBG, a collection of online technical assistance products.
So like you said, you're not flying blind.
Oh, wait a minute. The featured product that they have is CDBG timeliness and best practices to achieve timely performance.
Oh, so a blueprint on how to even execute.
This is ridiculous.
Oh, it's a video.
They got a video. Most definitely have a look. Okay. Find by topic. All products, activity type, grant line. I'm about to go to activity type.
Yes, you can. Can you go back to the first one and click the link where it said learn about the CDBG entitlement program eligibility requirements?
I got it.
All right.
I'm reading.
Yeah, you can. Yeah.
Okay. CDBG entitlement program eligibility requirements. The Community Development Block Grant, CDBG, entitlement program provides annual grants on a formula basis to entitled cities and counties to develop viable urban communities by providing decent housing and a suitable living environment, and by expanding economic opportunities, principally for low and moderate income persons. The program is authorized under Title I of the Housing and Community Development Act of 1974, Public Law 93-383, as amended, 42 USC 5301. HUD awards grants to entitlement community grantees to carry out a wide range of community development activities directed towards revitalizing neighborhoods, economic development, and providing improved community facilities and services. Entitlement communities develop their own programs and funding priorities. However, grantees must give a maximum feasible priority to activities which benefit low and moderate income persons. A grantee may also carry out activities which aid in the prevention or elimination of slums or blight.
Tell you that word again.
Blight. B-L-I-G-H-T.
Mm-hmm. Additionally, grantees may fund activities when the grantee certifies that the activities meet other community development needs having a particular urgency because existing conditions pose a serious and immediate threat to the health or welfare of the community where other financial resources are not available to meet such needs. CDBG funds may not be used for activities which do not meet one of these national objectives.
Here we go.
Hold on. Is it about to give you a list of things that don't qualify you and whatever's not on that list qualifies?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, man. What's eligible right now?
I hope y'all got y'all ideas out.
Eligible grantees. Eligible grantees are as follows. Principal cities of metropolitan statistical areas, MSAs, other metropolitan cities with population of at least 50,000, qualified urban counties with population of at least 200,000, excluding the population of entitled cities. Eligibility for participation as an entitlement community is based on the population data provided by the U.S. Census Bureau and metropolitan...
What was that again? Based on what?
It's based off of the United States Census Bureau.
Well. Okay.
And metropolitan area delineation published by the Office of Management and Budgets. HUD.
Allocation of resources.
Yes, it is. HUD determines the amount of each entitlement grantee's annual funding allocation by a statutory dual formula, which uses several objectives, measures of community needs, including the extent of poverty, population, housing overcrowding, age of housing, and population growth lag in relationship to other metropolitan areas. Eligible activities. CDBG.
Hold on. Before we go down there, I wanted to go back up to the top where it was like, what makes you an eligible grantee? Basically, a metropolitan city where the population is at least 50,000.
Yep.
Or qualified urban counties where the population is at least 200,000.
Hold on, man. That sounds like a Google search away from where you at.
That sounds like every place we at. Nah. I mean, yeah, we could go on. I just wanted to point that out real quick, that when you look at the numbers, rurally, anything that's 50,000 and under, a qualified urban area, 200,000. Whole lot of qualified people. I'm sorry about that. We can go on.
Eligible activities. CDBG funds may be used for activities which include, but are not limited to, acquisition of real property, relocation and demolition, rehabilitation of residential and non-residential structures, construction of public facilities and improvements, such as water and sewer facilities, streets, neighborhood centers, and the conversion of school buildings for eligible purposes. Public services within certain limits. Activities relating to energy conservation and renewable energy resources. Provision of assistance for a profit-motivated business to carry out economic development and job creation retention activities. Each activity must meet one of the following national objectives for the program. Benefit low and moderate income persons, prevention or elimination of slum or blight. Wait, I'm reading that again. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
or address community development needs having a particular urgency because existing conditions pose a serious or immediate threat to health or welfare of the community for which other funding is available. Generally, the following types of activities are ineligible: acquisition, construction, or reconstruction of buildings for the general conduct of government, political activities, certain income payments, construction of new house. Construction of new housing with some exceptions.
Basically meaning you just can't use this and be outside of the qualified areas building houses. That if it's new house being constructed, it has to be in the USDA qualified area.
Eligible beneficiaries over a 1, 2, or 3 year period as selected by the grantee, not less than 70% of CDBG funds must be used for activities that benefit low and moderate income persons.
Basically, they just want to use 70% of the funding, use it to take care of your people.
I hope people is paying attention and listening, because if you pay attention to what's going on in your city and what's going around you, HUD,
you'll see it. Oh, yeah. I'm sorry, Gabrielle.
No. I apologize. No, I'm just. And then if you're paying attention, being that there is HUD funding, community block grants in your county, in your city, and then you can see how those funds are being used.
Yeah, look at it this way. They say you can't use construction of new housing, but then it tells you with some exceptions. We know it's some exceptions. You know how you know? Because back in the qualifying on what you can use it for, relocation and demolition. Mm-hmm. Basically, see what happens in a lot of our communities. They come in, relocate the people, knock it down, and build new buildings. They're telling you how it can be used. As long as it's being used in that area, yeah, new construction. Basically, again, you can't take the funding and run to another state and build there. It doesn't work that way.
HUD does not provide CDBG assistance directly to individuals, businesses, nonprofit, or organizations, or other non-governmental entities. If you are interested in participating in this program, you need to contact your local, municipal, or county officials to find out how the program operates in your area. Participation requirements may differ from one grantee to another. Find out who administers the CDBG program in your area. If your local government officials cannot answer your questions, or if you are a local official, contact HUD field office that serves your area. Note that the local government administers the program and determines which local projects receive funding.
Again, this is showing you the importance of being active in your community, knowing who your local government representatives are, having input in the say-so on who are your local representatives. Again, this is showing you the importance of our participation, and mainly on the local level. Because again, imagine the whole picture. We are participating in our local politics. We're in our communities. We're getting candidates that represent us, that come from us. We're electing them in these positions in our areas. Again, who can address the needs of the people better than the people? Again, it's, whew.
citizen participation. A grantee must develop and follow a detailed plan which provides for and encourages citizen participation, and which emphasizes participation by persons of low or moderate income, particularly residents of predominantly low or moderate income neighborhoods, slum or blight areas, and areas in which the grantee proposes to use CDBG funds. The plan must provide citizens with reasonable and timely access to local meetings, information, and records related to the grantee's proposed and actual use of funds. Provide for public hearings to obtain citizen views and to respond to proposals and questions at all stages of the community development program, including at least the development of needs, the review of proposed activities, and review of program performance. Provide for timely written answers to written complaints and grievances. Identify how the needs of non-English speaking residents will be met in the case of public hearings where a significant number of non-English speaking residents can be reasonably expected to participate. In May 12, 2012, HUD introduced the Econ Planning Suite, including the consolidated plan template in IDIS online and the CPD MAPS website, by creating a more cohesive planning and grants management framework and providing better data and a tool for analysis. The Econ Planning Suite supports grantee and the public to access the public to assess their needs and make strategic investment decisions. HUD grantees are now required to submit their consolidated plan and year one annual action plan using the consolidated plan template in IDIS online. If grantees have an approved multi-year consolidated plan, they are not required to use IDIS to submit their annual action plan until the next multi-year strategy is due. So not only does it tell you how you're eligible and ineligible, it also tells you how you have to establish it to make it to where citizens, for citizen participation, it has to be, you have to put it out there so that people can be notified of meetings, you get input from the public and everything.
But I would like to go back up as well and click the link where it says find out who administers the CDBG program in your area.
Okay.
I went to that link.
Yeah, it says about grantees.
Right.
Find contact information, reports, awards, jurisdiction, and other data for organizations that receive HUD funding. HUD grantees receive funding from HUD to support HUD's mission to create strong, sustainable, inclusive communities and quality, affordable homes for all. HUD grantees include state and local governments, nonprofit and for-profit organizations, public housing authorities, and tribal entities. Again, HUD grantees include state and local governments, nonprofit and for-profit organizations, public housing authorities, and tribal entities. Then they have a search by state or by name or by program where you can search for a specific grantee and view its awards, contact information, reports, and more. There's a page where a link where you can actually narrow down to find out who get in the HUD funding, who to go to, who you need to be contacting. Everything is basically there for you.
Yep. I definitely, and if you you can click and see how much they were granted or how much they granted.
Yeah, how much they was awarded, yeah.
Yep. I saw one for somewhere in Virginia was awarded twice in 1 year. So it's out there, it's being used, being utilized. Utilize it.
And again, like Gabrielle was saying, it walks you through what you can and can't do. You have templates on how to put it together. Donation lists on who getting it, contacts on who you need to be in contact with. how to go about it. I mean, to me, it just seems like we got the playbook, we got the plays. We just got to get active and run them.
Whoa.
What you got? Drop it like it's hot.
Man, so I put in one program in here to see if they have received any awards. Nothing came up on the housing authority that I know that's in this area. So then I just put in North Carolina to see all the counties and all the programs, and some are just listed just as the city itself.
Yep. Yes, it is. Man, oh man. Yes, it is. I'm looking at a few cities around me now.
So think about what that's telling you. That's a whole city funded by community block development grants. Mm-hmm.
And interesting, if I just go off of my city, just my city, yeah, the whole city, that, oh my goodness.
Yeah.
It's not even listed as individual business. It's listed as just the city.
I'm clicking all cities around me right now and anything that has a city's name in it on those lists. I want to know.
I think we was having that conversation over this weekend as well, is that the more and more you learn about these programs and the different programs, you start to realize the majority of stuff that was built around you was built using these programs.
Mm-hmm. What are you going to tell?
Ooh.
You better not tell.
Think about what they say. 70% of it got to be used towards low, moderate income. Now you wonder why these people come in and throw up these community centers in your neighborhood. Sound like that 70% of all the funds being dumped back out.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you can add it. Insurance. This for you.
And I say that just to say this. Again, this is about us taking the responsibility to do this for ourselves. Because again, it takes nothing special. It's about us getting our situations together and minding our business. Getting our business affairs in order, putting together infrastructure and institutions in place so we can maximize this. Again, all of us have different skill sets. And basically for every skill set that there's in this community, there's a grant for.
That's why I say get your ideas out.
Again, basically for every skill set in the community, there's a grant for.
Man, has that been said online?
I don't know.
I ain't heard nobody say it, and it's kind of gut-wrenching a little bit to know that this ain't just happened in 2020. This has been going on for years and years and years and years and years. So, yeah. Get your ideas out or keep complaining.
I mean, think about it. Everybody just came off from watching a big game. It was funded off of community block grants, hood funding, Section 3, USDA. Basically, yeah. All the same programs that we're running through and many more. These are the same mechanisms that's behind these entities in your everyday life.
there's no way that they're providing this amount of housing. There's no way.
Oh, it is. Think about it.
Oh, shoot. I'm off mute. I'm sorry.
They can apply it as a mixed income community. Mixed income communities are still under HUD. How does it become a mixed income community again? By not participating in the census allows them to be like, okay, there's a population that's not here and we have to bring people in to fill it up. Because cities and towns are ran off of tax dollars. So they're going to try to keep their population. They want a population to keep rising, believe it or not, because that's the more funding the city going to receive. That's why the city pushes so hard for people to participate.
I'm looking at the city. Go ahead. Good.
No, go ahead.
So I'm looking at the city of Chesapeake. That's a city in Virginia. 2019, 2018, and 2017, they were awarded through the CDBG program. That's just the CDB. That's not the only awards they got. $1,093,950, $1,182,627 in 2018, 2017, $1,028,373. That was the city of Chesapeake. That's not the only CDBGs given out in Chesapeake. That was just the city of Chesapeake's. That was just the city of Chesapeake. That wasn't any housing authorities. That wasn't any groups like us or anybody getting the city. That was just the city of Chesapeake got clear. They have it for every city. Suffolk, Norfolk, Virginia Beach, Newport News, Hampton. Shout out to the 757. Man, what's going on?
Yeah.
They got a few more award links. That ain't even a whole list.
Yeah, anybody who got the time, click the link. It's an actual active link. It will show you, see for yourself the things around you that are being funded. And it gives you a better idea on what you can tap into. And it's just like in cases to where when you're dealing with your city and there's people in there telling you that they don't have it or they don't know about it, then you can point it out to them how you don't know about something that's on a thing that you receive X amount of dollars for.
Come on, son.
Relatives, and that's when we come together as brothers and sisters and realize that's waste, fraud, and abuse. And if it takes us speaking out,
oh my goodness,
let it be known. We're out here with that chicken and waffles.
Because if we don't say anything, what's going to happen? People are going to keep using it because we are choosing to remain silent.
They out here waffles with chicken. We have a voice.
And our voice matters because we say it matters. That's why our voice matters, because we say it, dude. We use it. Mm-hmm. But if you don't use it, you don't speak out, what good is it?
Oh, no.
Oh, when you go on that link, on one we posted today, what's that, learning who administrates the CDBG in your area, you can put your area in, and you can see who are around you, what cities, what towns, what counties are funded this way.
Can we drop that link, please? Because that is an important link itself. That blue link that you're talking about, Bones. I gotta hold up. I'm like, Gabrielle, you in the chat?
Back in the chat.
If not, yeah. I'm talking to kick you out again. So listen to this. I just clicked Virginia Beach, the city of, because I didn't do Virginia Beach by itself. I did one of the housing authorities or something, but check this out. 2019, recent awards. So not all the awards, just recent awards. CDB, this is, and I only search, and you can narrow it down to all the programs that whatever you click has, you can narrow it down to which one you want to read that they are awarded, or all of them. I'm just doing the CDBG. Shout out to today's topic. And we know what it is, and to give your contact, point of contact person with their name, the address, and their phone number, and their email address, the field office. Anyway, 2019 awards from CDBG was $2,488. 2018, $2,832, City of Virginia Beach. 2017, $1,008,000. 2016, $1,007,000. 2015, $1,007,000. View more awards. There's more awards that they were awarded. That's just CDBGs that I was clicking on right there. This is, man. And they've been getting it for all these consecutive years. Sometimes they get more in certain years than they do in the other years. They never missed a year getting CDBG.
Nope. I've got it from 2003 to 2019, but I've seen the amount decrease.
Look, I see.
Remember, me and you had a conversation earlier before we went live, Gabrielle.
Yeah.
Because of that town situation and their fight, that funding, you get what I'm saying? That's why that's happening.
Yeah.
So you can, again, the more and more that you learn about it, you understand how the cities and local government work.
Yeah.
Why it's very important to be a part of it. Because again, brothers and sisters, we can affect actual change at that level. Because again, if we start working with each other in our communities, in our streets, go back to actually talking to one another, sitting down, working together, drafting plans together, and start putting our own people in these local political seats. It can be done. I mean, it's being done.
Yeah,
posted the link in the chat so you can put your city area. Yeah, please, yeah, take the time out, check it out. Don't let nobody tell you. You can see for yourself. Don't let nobody tell you. Click the link, that's see for yourself.
Oh man, proof is not a problem at all. These are hot links that we did not make up. We don't own these websites.
Coming straight from community, coming straight from hood. Just like registering up as a Section 3 business or a Section 3 resident. And like I said before, once you register up as a Section 3 business, your next step would be find a Section 3 resident. You would want to start hiring them. Even if you just hire one of them to start getting involved in the program and the funding. That's how it works. As a Section 3 business, you would want to hire Section 3 residents because you're providing a service to a community. See, you don't have to wait to get the multi-million dollar project to start helping people in your community. Those of us who own businesses and companies, if we can, we taking in an employee, you registering up for Section 3. Pull somebody off the list. Again, start accessing these benefits and these fundings. Let's start taking on the responsibility of taking care of our own. I mean, ain't nobody else gonna come do it. And we brag about being the best at doing everything else, shooting a basketball, running a basketball, dancing, singing, jumping. When we gonna brag about being the best to ever taking care of our responsibility, being the best to take care of our elders, our children, being the best of building the infrastructure that lasts the test of time. That's what I'm talking about. We talk about people complain about records and who keep it and this and that. But guess what? It's nothing to start your own genealogy society. And be the keeper of your own records. Again, by starting a genealogy society, that allows you to work with these institutions, these colleges, these anthropologists, archaeologists, and be able to go out and get them to dig at particular areas, to dig at particular sites. But then again, don't take my word for it. There's information all in the form. We've been broke down to 501c3s or the 50c1s. All this stuff is doable. It's up to us again.
Where are we at in the reading? Citizen participation, did we already read that?
Uh-huh. I was pulling something real quick, pulling this link for us to go through real quick. No, just sent to the article. And we're gonna thank Copper Color Ancestor because she sent it to me over the weekend. The one about the community. I'm posting it in the chat right now. Because, you know, like we always say, proof is not a problem. Put it in the chat. I'll read the title of it. Just reading the title on how they got it written in here. It says, Black woman developer felt unwelcomed in neighborhood, so she built her own community. Again, a melanated woman developer felt uncommon in a neighborhood, so she built her own community. Again, shout out to Copper Color Ancestor for sending this link in over the weekend. Where we always say, proof is not a problem. Somebody was able to read it right now, or
you got it in our back chat?
I put it in.
Yeah, I'm not on the website. Hold on.
I can put it in the back chat.
Just put it in Carol. I might have it. Hold on. No, I don't have it. I thought I had it. That was the one you sent before, right? The 51.
Yeah, I just posted it in there.
Word. All right, I'm ready. Mic check.
Loud and clear. Proof is not a problem.
You breaking up a little bit, Bones. Did you hear the chicken? All right. Black. Woman developer felt unwelcome in neighborhood, so she built her own community. Pam Brown Courtney was impressed with the community in her hometown of Little Rock, so she went to check it out. The neighborhood was beautiful, nice and quaint, but the people most certainly were not. As she went to look at some of the homes, it became obvious that the people were not very friendly towards her, and so she decided that she didn't want to live there. Pam got the bright idea to hotlink, build her own community, where she would be nice to everyone there, and so she did just that. Covenant Cove Community exists as a result. Hotlink Covenant Cove Community is a residential and corporate lease community built from scratch. The neighborhood consists of only 51 beautiful, custom-built designer homes, making Covenant Cove an exclusive destination for families. Each home comes with an array of bells and whistles, like 12-foot ceilings, architectural crown molding, hardwood, plush carpet or tile flooring, designer paint, jacuzzi bathtubs, standalone showers, large walk-in closets, security system, professional landscaping, beans, greens, tomatoes, potatoes, and sprinkler systems. You name it.
You name it!
Lord, the love and care Pam put into her community is evident, and the results speak loudly. The existence of Covenant Cove Community is particularly impressive when its location is considered. Covenant Cove is located in Little Rock, Arkansas. Arkansas was a state to be committed to race.
Where?
Covenant Cove, sounds nice and quaint, is located in Little Rock, Arkansas was a state so committed to racial segregation that after the Brown versus Board of Education case was decided, then Governor Orville Faubus opted to close down Little Rock's public high schools for 1 year rather than integrate. Indeed, it was only by intervention of the National Guard that the quote unquote Little Rock Nine integrated Little Rock Central High School. One of the Little Rock Nine, Elizabeth Eckford, tried to escape the abuse of a mob one day and ran to Ponder's Drugstore, located across the street from the high school. They locked the door in her face, turning her away. Today, Pam owns the Ponders building and is renovating it.
Ain't that something?
excuse me. Self-determination and ownership is the pathway forward, and this Black woman is modeling it. Little Rock has a troubled past and is at times scary present. Still, Pam Brown Courtney is determined to walk in her own power and create a new identity for herself and her city. It matters not who is unwelcoming when you have your own.
You'll read that again, that last line. That's so powerful.
It matters not who is unwelcoming when you have your own.
Facts. So again, thanks again to Copper Ancestor again for sending that link in. Like I said, a powerful read. And again, proof is not a problem.
Sure ain't.
It's showing that this woman built a community. So, and this article isn't then outdated. It's the date on it right here is
19, man. December 2nd, 2019. Shout out to DeJuan Hopewell. DeJuan Hopewell.
Yep. About 2 months ago.
So, if you click on that link that was at the first paragraph, and she talks
about links to build her own community. Hot link. Go ahead, Gabriel.
Okay, let me go back because I clicked on her webpage and all.
I clicked on it too.
Okay,
meet the lady. Oh, that's another
okay,
article.
There it
you
is.
Try to read that one too. Oh, it's an interview. What? It's an interview.
I mean, it's how she got started, what's important, what she learned, what she did. Am I reading it or?
Let's see how long this interview is.
Yeah, I mean, we can read it. We can break it down.
Yeah, it's not that long. Yeah.
I mean, again, it's showing proof is not a problem. That you can access these programs and you can build a community. That we can come together and fix our communities, fix our conditions. So, yeah.
And then, if you scroll, okay. Okay. Pam Brown Courtney is a real estate developer, investor, and educator. She's also the only person I know of that has built a 51 home subdivision from scratch. Obviously, we had to know more about this amazing woman. How did you get started in the real estate? A friend of mine's mother was a real estate investor, and I started volunteering to help her keep up with her files, collect her rent, and help her clean out her rental houses. So the more I volunteered to help her, the more she taught me, and the more she taught me, the more I liked. The more I liked it, the more I loved it. And the more I loved it, it was the more I asked her about it. That's how she taught me, and that's how I got started. What inspired you to develop Covenant Cove Community? I saw this amazing community in Little Rock that looks similar to mine. In my opinion, it had the same kind of feel to it. It was cute, and it was small. It was just a nice little community. So I went over there to the community to look around at some of the houses, and the people weren't friendly toward me. I didn't want to live in a neighborhood where people weren't friendly. So I went home and said, you know what? I can build my own community like that. And I'll be nice to the people that live there. That's exactly where the idea came from. How did you locate and decide on the location for Covenant Cove? The Universal God gave the location to me. I'd like to make it sound really fancy, like I hired some architects, engineers, realtors, prospect lookers, and investors. That sounds real professional and all of that, but the real prophetic thing is that I asked the universal God to help me. I told him I was new at this and I needed some guidance and direction. He sent me to a vacant piece of land and said, here it is, right here. I don't even think it had a for sale sign on it. It was just a vacant piece of woods, and the universal God said, this is it. This is what I've been saving for you. That's the truth. I know it doesn't sound all fancy, but I've got to give it to you. That's just the way I received it. One of your renovation projects in particular seems to have special personal meaning. Can you explain why the Ponder's Drugstore project may be especially important to you? Ponder's Drugstore has special meaning to me because I'm a Little Rock Central High alumni, class of 1982. The older I get, the more I realize the benefit of being able to graduate from Little Rock Central High School. With all that happened in 1957, Ponder's is really dear to me because Elizabeth Eckford, one of the Little Rock Nine, tried to escape the loveless behavior of the mob that was being rude to her, and she went to Ponder's and they locked the door in her face and wouldn't let her in. So now that we own Ponder's, we are going to unlock the door and allow everybody that's anybody to join in with all the good things we have to offer them with our upcoming Student Educational Historic District. And then there's a photo, September 4th, 1957, students of Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas, shout insults at Elizabeth Eckford as she calmly walks toward a line of National Guardsmen. The district will be the new home of entrepreneurship, financial literacy, science, technology, engineering, arts, math, professional development, and so much more for all students. Why is it important for you to speak to the younger generation about real estate? It is important to me because someone invested that into me. Someone planted the seed of hope in me. I'm not going to say that every young person should get involved in real estate. As a matter of fact, I don't think they should. What I do think is true is that I want to expose young people to real estate and what's available in the real estate world. With that being done, they get to decide. You can't choose to do something if you don't know it exists.
I think I say it again.
You can't choose to do something if you don't know it exists.
Man, shout out to the young adults coming up right now.
Man. So my job is just to plant.
Told me that.
So my job is to plant the seed and create options. That's one of my favorite words, options.
I mean, that's our main goal here at Tontonist Assembly. It's just to inform people, not to impose. We can't make no one do anything. That's not our intention. Just to inform you on this information so you know what's available.
Absolutely.
You are aware of what's here. You know that you don't have to give in, that you can get your way out of these situations. That mm-hmm. there are programs out here that help you become self-sufficient. And not only programs, that there's other like-minded individuals thinking, feeling, living the same way. And it just takes us communicating with each other and seeing what we can do as a community to fix our individual communities and bring us all up together. When I mean all, it's not going to be everyone, because there's never going to be a time when everyone's going to get along. That's a fantasy, because we all come from different walks of life. We all have different experiences, and that's why we see things particular ways. If we all seen stuff the same way, it'd be kind of bland and boring.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, but really, this is something that we can accomplish in our lifetime. Right, fast cop color ancestor facts.
I'd like you to know what options are available. And if I expose you to them, now you know they exist. And you get to do with that information what you wish, but you can't decide what you want to do if you don't know it exists. What advice do you have for a new real estate investor? Oh my goodness, what advice do I have for beginners in real estate? Take my course, spend some time with me. That's the most important thing you should do, in my opinion. Why should you take my course? Because I'm going to teach you how not to make a lot of the mistakes I made. And most importantly, I'm going to make sure that you learn real life real estate and not just learn enough about the real estate market where you can go out and be dangerous. I don't want you to go out and make mistakes and you find yourself in a worse situation than what you were in before you got started. That's not what I want. I want you to learn the basics of real estate. The foundational principles of real estate do not change. They don't change if you're doing a $100 deal or if you're doing a $1 million deal. So I want my students to learn the basics of doing real estate right now.
Foundational principles of real estate do not change.
That foundation, because that foundation's solid. It doesn't matter what you throw at it in the future. You can always reconstruct it because you have a solid foundation to start from. But if that foundation and the fundamentals are crooked, oh yeah, it ain't going too far.
The advice that I give to them is take your time, do your due diligence, and study, study, study. What does that mean? The old people used to say, measure twice and cut once. I say measure 3 or 4 times and then cut once. So do your due diligence before you sign your name on the dotted line. That's the most important thing. Before you sign your name on the dotted line, do your due diligence. And then it says, find out more about Pam Brown Courtney and her projects on her website. You can sign up for her course here.
Fire.
I mean, again, proof that it can be done. This article is from December 2nd, 2019. Again, December 2nd, 2019.
Actually, she's got 3 communities now.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm just talking about the date of the article.
Yeah.
And that interview was from January, so it seems like she's been doing it. She's since been doing it.
Community! Oh, she did this in Arkansas.
Mm-hmm.
You said Arkansas? Arkansas?
Which I, for a fact, land is dirt cheap out there. I think lost 2 nights of sleep going over that chart.
Oh, wow. Look, did you see what she did to the drugstore?
Break it on down.
That's what the entrepreneur thing is? Or what was?
Man, she built that thing up.
She ain't get mad. She didn't say, we need to tear it down, burn it down. No, she got her affairs together, got her business right, bought it, and rebuilt it to what she wanted it to represent. And think about it now. Whether you agree with the history that they're going to tell African-American or African slaves or this or that, basically, they gave themselves that right by taking control of it for themselves. So now they can dictate the history and the stories that's told from there. And all I'm saying is imagine when we do that for ourselves. We, the American Indian, the remnant, when we do this, and again, we talking about Arkansas.
Mm-hmm.
Arkansas, y'all, she pulled this off.
Mm-hmm.
And I won't even say pulled it off. No, she did this in Arkansas. Yep,
exactly.
She ain't have to pull nothing. She did this. Now, just imagine how many more. And again, imagine when we we know the templates and infrastructures of setting up our own businesses and corporations. We know about the funding. We know about community gardens and access and farming. We're digging deeper into housing and community development. Again, basically all the tools we need to fix our condition, to change our way of life, is right in front of us. And the good thing about it, now we know. We don't got to guess. We don't have to sit here thinking no scheme. We don't have to listen to nobody try to pitch you no scheme, because now you know.
You got options.
Again, don't like what the education system is doing with our children. We had the ability to set up our own schools. It don't have to start as a physical building again. The same technology, how we come here, meet up every rising, can also be used to have an online school.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, it has to come from us the people. We have to put the time in to build it. Build it, get it up, get it running, so we can start bringing our people in, so we can get it to the point to where these programs that we design can receive funding. Again, all of us have different skill sets, but by using these skill sets together, there's nothing that we can't build. There's nothing that we can't overcome. We have all the pieces that we need. And again, if this don't show the importance of taking the responsibility of who we allow to represent us and speak to us, because Queen Copper said it perfect. We never had to guess, and we should have always known that we have options. So now you have to question. If the people that's representing you are not informing you, then we have to change that as well. We have to inform ourselves and put people in there with the information that's going to let our people know that there are options, that we're not boxed into a corner, that we're not this label that was created for us. And Queen Copper said they got their own school and community, and it still exists. It has been done. Relatives, all I can say is our time now. Time to get it. I mean, any other thoughts from the panel? I mean, that's just how I personally feel like, hey, it's time to get it.
Yes, sir. It's out there. Definitely out there.
And again, we don't have to rush and jump into anything. We take the time out to inform ourselves. Get as much information of our communities and our areas and the needs of the people of our community. So that way, in designing these programs to meet the requirements, to increasing your chance of receiving funding. I mean, everything there. Everything is there. Facts. And learn how to keep it. Facts. Not just getting it, maintaining it, passing it down. So the next generation don't have to start from scratch. They have a foundation that they can expand on. To lead to the next generation to expand more and keep expanding and keep expanding. That, relatives, is generational wealth. Again, generational wealth. No thoughts, Gabrielle?
Yeah, what click you
like? Oh, yeah, I got.
All right, she was kind of quiet for a long time over there.
Man.
You know he wasn't talking to me when he said any thoughts. What's wrong?
I thought I had clicked on some links in regards to this link over the weekend, but now that I'm pulling it up on the computer and clicked on some other stuff, this just gives me a whole nother idea in regards to the community garden. This just kind of I mean, yeah, you can't unhear what you hear. You can't unknow what you know.
You can't unclick what you clicked.
Nope. You can't. and I mean, this is something that Bones has been saying, TMH, you, I, this is something Doodoo Vision, Copper, and you can't unhear. So even reading in this article where she says in the article, you know, you don't know what to do unless you know that it's out there. You know, there's resources. For her to put this in the article, that's a reiteration of, look, it's out there. There are options. There are resources out there. You just got to know. So yeah, this, man, what we doing?
And I want to bring something back up that TMA said, and it's very important. The maintaining of it, of the start of this generational wealth, goes back to those constitution and bylaws. It's how you structure it.
Yep.
You structure these companies to stand the test of time on what it's designed to do. And that's where the information comes in. And it's not hard as well, because there's free information on that, on every form of business you can think of. You can even go online to your local small business association. They got completely free walkthroughs. The one thing is, there's information out there. But now you know what information to look for. And not only just look for the information, get it and start applying it. That's what's up, Queen Copper. Like she said, she also started community gardens. They also have occupied gardens to help others start home gardens. And these are all things that we can do for ourselves as a community, and it's major benefits. Again, it's just taking that responsibility of doing for ourselves, minding our business. Something's not right. Remember, we have the ability to change it. But if we never get up and move, how can it change? It takes movement. It takes action to spark change. A thought is just an idea, but if you never move on it, it's just wasted time. I mean, I'm saying it again, we got the playbook, y'all.
Open book, Tef.
Man.
I mean, I really don't know too much more to say on it. It shows again that it has been done, that it can be done. And it's just up to us to decide, are we going to take the opportunity and start doing it for ourselves? Is that we all know the problems of our communities, and we all know complaining don't do anything. But now we know how, where to go to start making changes. And not just temporarily, but long-term course changing changes. Again, what's better than taking on our own responsibility? And like Copper Color Ancestors say, all of this is improving the quality of life for our community residents. And Queen Copper is an example of this being done. So even in the community, you have living proof that you can conversate with, reach out to, of this being done. Ask information. That's what we're here for, to conversate amongst each other, to start implementing this information in our communities, to start changing, to start building, but really building.
Yeah, we're not reading fairy tales. Like, this is really happening. This is really going on. It's not impossible.
And remember this, if we don't do it, then other organizations and entities are going to come in, turn on communities into mixed neighborhoods, and we'll have nobody to blame but ourselves. Especially now. I mean, we definitely can't buck, especially not no one here. If we turn our back, I mean, that's very shameful, because all of us here, we are aware now. So to me, I'm like, we only have one. There's only one choice. And it's easy. We start doing this. We start communicating with each other. We have to open up the line on the weekend for how many hours for people just to call in and be the facilitators of that. So be it. It's whatever we need to get this done, to start getting this on the ball. We bring the farming information because we know the farming season coming up. For those who are interested, they can start getting in plans and information so they can start receiving funding. Show community gardens, because it's an easy way to start benefiting your community, and it costs you nothing. Again, nothing. There's a walkthrough.
Nothing.
To where you can get a community garden basically for free. I mean, whew, I don't know what more to say. Not dealing with this here. If this is time for us to get together and start doing the work, a Tontonist assembly. That's what we're here for. When I say we, I don't mean the panel. I mean the panel, the active chat, the silent majority. That's what we are here for. I mean, it's still the top of the year. This is the time to start putting these plans on paper, start working with like-minded people, start getting involved locally in your community. Find out what's the needs of the local community. Start getting this information and stuff together. Also, you know the census coming up. The census is going to dictate how funding going to be redistributed during over what, the next 10 years. So, I mean, the timing for this is perfect for us to start getting our affairs together, to start getting on the move with this. I mean, there's full videos on how to put your proposals together in line on what they require. So you don't have to worry about making mistakes. To me, if somebody already did it, made the mistake, they can show you the mistake. And I'm gonna watch them make the mistake and go out and make the same mistake.
Oh, I just had an idea.
What's that?
Well, to get people actively aware, because I mean, as far as the census and what it entails, what it involves, how it benefits the community, and you know where people are at, like doing some type of, I don't know, function or something. Get businesses involved, you know, like, I don't know, food or something. Do the census, you know, I don't know, something.
I mean, for me, the first thing that you can do is talk among the group of people that you hang with and yeah, do it in a way to where you're not imposing it. Just inform people on why it's important.
Right.
Even the information that you're getting here, the programs that we're exposing that been around. Because like we always say, this is not our information. We're just informing people on programs and information that we come across that we can use to fix our situation. That's proof that's working now and have been working and continue to keep working because the funding keep growing for it. I mean, whew.
No, it's not April Fool's Day.
And again, it starts when we take the opportunity. And again, if you're contacting your local area representatives and they're telling you it don't exist, this and that, then contact the next number. But document this. Because either way, if we're running into situations to where it's waste, fraud, and abuse, and people are taking advantage of the programs and it's not being used how it's supposed to be used, that's what we have a voice for. If it's not pointed out and bought out, then how can that change? So either way, we have to take action. Again, none of us are alone, especially when we work at this as a community, as communities. We communicate within our communities and start forming communications between communities. I mean, so to me, that's the best thing that I can, that I would personally think to do, you know, just point out the importance of it on how participating in the census dictates your representation. Just by knowing that should let you know why it's in your best interest to be an active part in who your representation is, who your representative is. Because remember, these are the individuals that you're voting to send to Congress to speak on your behalf. And think about it. You don't like the situation. We have the ability to put in candidates that do. And there's proof that that happens. You watch movements come your whole lifetime that were endorsed by presidential or Republican or congressional candidates. So there's proof all around you it can be done. But it takes us working as a community. The individuals part is getting the things that you have to get together personally to put yourself in a better situation to take advantage of this. That making sure that you inform yourself on how to access it. So again, when you're designing the programs or working with like-minded people to come up with the programs to benefit the community, you're actually designing programs that benefit the community. Because again, we're not trying to be right. We're trying to get it right. And part of getting it right is make sure that when we design this, that these communities, these institutions, this infrastructure, when our time has come and gone, that they're still here doing what we designed them to do. To make sure that we have good, clean, affordable, functioning communities, good quality food, building infrastructure and jobs for our people. That again, by us choosing to be active, we can change. And the expectation should not be to get everybody to change, because again, all you can do is inform, expose people to the information.
Options.
Then it becomes on that individual to make a choice. The best thing you can do is let them know, like Nocella just said, that there are options. Because again, the lot of conditions that's in our communities and neighborhoods come about because people don't believe there's an option. They don't think they have a choice. And not making an excuse for it, because you do have a choice. No matter what it is, you always have a choice. But now you know what choices you can make to better the situations. And you can also understand why certain things were done or are being done in your community. You know, by taking the time out, again, getting involved locally. Those of us who live locally around each other, if it means getting together and having a representative that can go down to these local meetings to represent this group, then that's what we have to start doing. Me and Nocella was having a conversation about, it's kind of funny that they give us this technology and all this social media stuff, but it made us antisocial.
Facts.
That when it comes out to reality, that we don't socialize with each other. We don't really get to know each other out here in the real world, locally, to where we can actually make change. So we can actually meet like-minded people and sit down at our tables locally and start putting plans together. Even just to find out what available resources are in your area. Because then that allows communities to start setting up particular infrastructures and trading and working in between communities. I mean, I could be wrong, but to me, it seems like the solution, and I'm not saying that this is the only one, because there's multiple different ways, but the one to me, it seems like that works, is taking on the responsibility to build and provide for yourself by accessing the programs that basically everything around us, our whole lives, have been utilizing.
Years and years and years and years been utilized.
I mean, there's representatives that's accessing these funds on your head, but not being put back out in your benefit. And it's half and half. Yes, there's a whole lot of waste, fraud, and abuse. But then again, there's a whole lot of us that are not participating, that are not speaking up. I mean, again, first things first. We can fix our conditions. And during the time of getting out, working with your community and stuff, getting to know one another, that gives you the chance to bring in the conversations about genealogy amongst your neighbors, amongst other friends and like-minded people. I mean, it seems to me, coming up and sitting down at the table, fixing the conditions that people have today is a perfect icebreaker for the conversation amongst our people about genealogy. Because genealogy is about getting to know your family tree, where you come from. I mean, I could be wrong, but to me, it seems like it goes hand in hand.
We keep having conversations outside of genealogy that tie back in genealogy. So, yeah.
I mean, we are the solution. When people keep asking us, we are the solution, meaning our activity, our voice, our choices, our movements are the solution. It's either the solution to staying on a path of destruction or the solution of fixing our communities and giving the next generation a platform with a proven, stable foundation that honestly allow them to realistically expand on to build. Not something that they have to worry, spend the majority of their time trying to patchwork. No, we can take the time out to get it right. I mean, if there's nothing else, we can go ahead and give our closing statements and let everyone get on about their day. Closing remarks, Gabrielle.
Get on them link.
Wait, I thought Double Cousin was going.
Why would I do that? You always go first.
Okay, fine then. Okay, so yeah. Continue on your genealogy journey. Know who you are so that no one can tell you who you are. Census. not just the census. I mean, the census is coming up, but census, it affects not just funding, but how you're represented. You got to count so that you can be counted. So yeah, get actively involved in your neighborhood, your community, in your city. Know what's going on so that you can understand and you can see. You can be a part of to make change. Yeah, we got some stuff to do. Shout out to Double Cousin. Thank you for sharing these wise words once again. Appreciate it. Some are reiterations, but you know, even record burns a needle. If you try and lose, then it isn't your fault. But if you don't try and we lose, then it's all your fault. The people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. The only limit to the height of your achievements is the reach of your dreams and your willingness to work for them. So yeah, let's communicate. Let's get actively involved. Let's stop being disassociated. Have a beautiful day, everyone.
All right, what you got for us, Salat?
Nothing. Questions, comments, concerns, and or corrections, please email attentionassembly@gmail.com. We have a phone number that you can call and get on the line with us if you have any further questions or new questions or questions in general or statements. Yeah, man, y'all got options. We all got options. Everyone has options. Sorry, I was getting a phone call. Can you hear me? Mic check, mic check.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Everyone has options. So, get your ideas out, start writing them down, and start doing some research or asking some questions. And if you can't get an answer, ask the next person on the list that same question. And if you can't get an answer, man, call us. Just hit us up. No more of that waffles with your chicken. Peace, y'all.
Oh, wait. I got one more. I forgot. This is a quote from Muhammad Ali. Impossible is just a word thrown around by small men who find it easier to live in the world they've been given than to explore the power they have to change it. Impossible is not a fact. It is an opinion. Impossible is potential. Impossible is temporary. Impossible is nothing. That's it.
Nice quote.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Thanks again, No Sellout and Gabrielle, for what y'all do to make the show what it is on the panel every rising. Much appreciation to the active chat and the silent majority. And again, we're going to keep bringing information that we can use and access to change the conditions of our community, to change the direction, to give our future generations a platform, a solid foundation. And that it shows that people are doing it now. As we're speaking, people are doing it now. That it can be done. So again, continue working in your communities, getting to know the needs of your communities. Continue working on your genealogy to find out your family's history, where you come from, who you are. Continue to make sure that as we go through this information, that we never forget, we are not trying to get it right for personal gain, for no glory. we're getting it right because this is who we are. This is our story, where we come from. This is our moment that's being marked in history, where the American Indian chose to no longer remain silent, sit back and allow others to make our decisions for us, to just accept things the way that they are because someone says so. No. This will be marked at the time that we took upon ourselves to make the decision that we are going to step out, speak for ourselves amongst our community, get active, and change the way we do business, to start making sure that we build our institutions, our constitution and bylaws, to mind our business. So what we build today, brothers and sisters, will be here for seven generations. For what we build here today will be a reminder to any American Indian who's trying to find their way that there's a home for you, that you do not have to accept what people tell you it is, that you do have an option. You do have a choice. No longer thinking you have to be begging or beating on no one's door. We can do it for ourselves. And all it takes is us, brothers and sisters, deciding to do. And on that, remember, we love you. And until the next Rising Show, peace.
Messing with you, Gabrielle.
Peace, everybody.
Peace, y'all. I'm trying to go last. You go first, and then I go last.
Oh, yeah. Remember, but nothing is impossible.
More quotes.
The word alone means I'm possible.
You know what? Options, y'all. Options.
Yep.